Aloha tātou paurua. Aloha. O ki aina hanohano o hualalai a hiki kamai kaimalino. Aka kiela alima kaimalino. But ikiela iki ahi ahi. Mohalo I kapua. Kapua I ka maala malama ma palama nui. E mahalo nui I kia pua. Ka hele mai ana I kia muku o ki ave. Me ko ike. Me ka mana. Me ka na awao. Na mea paulua. Mahalo nui no ki hui ana. Ma ki aina. Mahalo. Dr. Puakea Nogelmeier is a professor at Kawaihui Center for Hawaiian Language at Hawaii Nui Akea School of Hawaiian Knowledge at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. He's also a director of the Institute of Hawaiian Language Research and Translation. He's taught over 30 years focusing on Hawaiian language, history, and literature. His BAs in Hawaiian language and anthropology, his MA in Pacific Island Studies, and his PhD in anthropology were all completed at the University of Hawaii. Dr. Nogelmeier has trained for decades in learning Hawaiian language, traditional dance, chant, and literature. He has gone through formal training and ceremonial graduation, uniki, as both a dancer, olapa, and a teacher of the dance, kumuhula. A prolific composer of Hawaiian poetry in both traditional and modern styles, his compositions are widely published and recorded. Dr. Nogelmeier is the founder and executive director of Avaya Ulu, training translators and researchers to do work with Hawaiian legacy materials and generating access for modern audiences to historical researchers, resources. And today's presentation covers that. He works extensively with the various Hawaiian language archives and is active in rearticulating historical Hawaiian knowledge into fields of study today, producing translations, new presentations, and reprints of archival materials for publication and dissemination. For the last two decades, Hawaiian language newspapers have been one of his central fields of research and study. Coming to Hawaii from Minnesota, he spent most of his adult life learning from respected elders and native speakers, who fostered an ever-growing interest in and respect for Hawaii, its people, and Hawaiian knowledge. Dr. Nogelmeier is an excellent example that, even though he may not be from these lands of Hawaii, he's embraced this culture, embraced the language, and not only has done that, but he said he's furthered the knowledge that he's in this language and this culture, and he's well-respected by many people. Not just by many people, by elders and scholars in Hawaiian language and culture. He's truly a respected person in his field. And we truly do have our deepest honor and respect for him and for what he's done for our language and our culture. As Dr. Nogelmeier has been quoted as saying to his students enrolled in his classes, quote, I'll give you much more than your 3 credits, but I considered your responsibility to pass it on, end of quote. However, you see, this afternoon, you won't be getting any 3 credits for his presentation. But we might be giving you an exam afterwards to see how much you've absorbed in his presentation. But despite that, this proverb, I would say, clearly envelops what he has to present for us today and what we hope that you gain from today's presentation. E lawe ke a'o I ka malama. Let me rephrase that again. E lawe ke a'o I ka malama. He who takes his teachings and applies them increases his knowledge. And with that, we'd like to truly welcome with great honor and respect, and Dr. Puakea Nogelmeier to here at Palama Nui.
Aloha, hi ahi kako, mahalo ke hele ana mai, a mahalo ya oa e kalani. ale ma'alahi ke la mo'olelo ano lo'ihi ke I Manawa. Thank you all for being here. And I love what I do. And I came to Hawaii when I was 18. And as an accident, I should introduce, I wasn't supposed to be in Hawaii. I was on my way to Japan. I was going to conquer the world. And I was 18 and I knew everything, so it was easy. I lost my wallet in the San Diego airport. And I was supposed to pick up my passport and my ticket in Honolulu. I was traveling with other friends who were coming here. So I was supposed to be here for the weekend, and that was in 1972. It's the longest weekend on record. It took about 6 months for my mother to send me a driver's license and a birth certificate. So the story went into, I ended up living in Waianae and learning from elders. I got swept into a halau hula because I was skinny and brown and not terribly shy. And that introduced me to language. I have no idea who all of you are, and I wish that we'd have time to meet because everybody's story is unique. But I step into Halau after living in Waianae for 2 years, and I'm stunned to find out we're learning a dance about a king in another language. Now that implies there was a kingdom and that there was another language, and that was news to me after 2 years in Waianae. And so it just became this fascination with what more? And then we did get, the question came up, how can you do this if you don't understand the language? And a piece I want to give you before I even launch into my topic is that you don't have to master the language. Any little bit that you learn opens up a broader window on the world that you're in. Because all of this underlies everywhere you walk, everywhere you sit, every breath you take. So even if you just learn a little bit of Hawaiian, it's more than you got today. So I should launch into a lecture, okay, because I know I only have an hour. And this looks like a kind of a boring topic. It's a boring title, maybe. And it's because the original story is the legacy of literacy. And I've told that story for a bit, and I think people are getting a little more familiar with it. So this is, there's a second part, this is a two-part talk, is, well, what are we doing about that? So here we launch, okay. And I'm just gonna pretend that you haven't heard any of this, and it's news, okay? So on we go. And it's not supposed to be a history lecture, but it sort of has to be a little bit, just to frame stuff. So Hawaiians get here somewhere, 300, they settle over the span of a few centuries back and forth, and they're here. Continual contact doesn't happen until 1778. There's earlier contact, that's pretty obvious, but nothing that lasts. So from Captain Cook forward, there's nonstop traffic. Every harbor's got visitors. The kingdom is established by Kamehameha by 1810 when he takes Oahu. But there's already a nation is in process. The idea of institutionalized chiefdom that can control a whole society is already in the works. So Kamehameha just kind of embodies it in one place. He sets up the kingdom, but it becomes a constitutional monarchy in 1840. And that's a big change for everyone. And that integrates it with a broader world. There's an overthrow in 1893. An alleged annexation, only because that's still, you know, very much called an annexation, but there doesn't seem to be any paperwork on that. Territory runs until 1959, statehood. And what excites me is, you know, cultural renewal. I land in 1972, and there's a renaissance going on, and that's what happened, is I got sucked into it. Language revitalization starts not much after that. So I've actually been playing with the players since that kicked off almost. And a big change that I don't even think people are totally aware of, there's been a new renaissance. Technology married to revitalization has created a renaissance of knowledge. We now have windows into places we didn't know were there, okay? So from first arrival, from the first ships of Captain Cook, Hawaiians wanted everything on those ships. They wanted the nails. They wanted the, you know, the clothes. They wanted everything. And most of it, you could get almost anything. For pigs or social time, you could get a hold of mirrors and knives and every, and literally the nails out of the planks. So, but a thing that they couldn't get, they saw it in motion, but they could not get it, was reading and writing, the technology of reading and writing. Vancouver describes that Kalani Moku, and I think it's Ke'eo Moku, would not leave the ship. They kept watching the map maker and the journalist. They just hung by his side watching what he was doing because it's so apparent. They're writing things down on paper. I give it to you. You give it to him, and he knows what I want. That is high technology. They can't get it. They want it. We know they want it. Kamehameha signs his name to the first letter to King George in 1796. This is the 1810. And, you know, even if it's not, I'm not even sure, I wasn't there, if he's the one who signed it. But the fact that Hawaiians wanted that writing, it shows up here. Kamehameha actually sets up a school for Liholiho and Kekoa Kalani in 1810. Gets Jean Reeves to teach them reading and writing. They're terrible students. It doesn't last. The missionaries are what makes it happen, but you know, it's a good point. People tend to think the missionary arrival happens in the middle of archaic Hawaii, you know, grand, ancient. No, no, no. Hawaiians have been at it for 40 years. They've had more visitors than most of New England already. These are missionaries, well, not, they're not quite missionaries, but this is actually a French ship with Catholic priests on it from 1819. This is before the missionaries arrived. And this is Kalani Moku gets baptized in 1819. Now, they've just overthrown, the Hawaiian chiefs have overthrown the kapu system. And he's not necessarily all intrigued with a, they're not looking for a new religion, they just got rid of one. But they are, he's open to it. And so he asks about what is this, what is it that you believe, and gets baptized. I don't think it lasts. He gets baptized as a Protestant about 5 years later. But it's 1820 that the missionaries arrive, and they almost aren't allowed to arrive. I don't know how much you know about that. Is they get to Kauai High, and Liholiho, who knows that his father had talked to Vancouver about religion, because Vancouver kept saying, wrong gods, you got the wrong gods. And Kamehameha said, well, they've taken care of me. And he said, how about if I put my man up on that cliff and you put your man up on that cliff? Let's see whose God saves who. Vancouver wouldn't take it. But so these missionaries, when they came, weren't Vancouver's missionaries. So Liholiho originally said, nah, these aren't the ones that my father asked for. It's like, we'll wait for the pizza we ordered. And so it was Keopuolani who said, give them a chance. Let's say, you know, there's, I think there's 20 on board, 25, I forget the number, but she says, let them, and he gives them a one-year lease. But Kamehameha is in charge of the island chain. Or this is now Liholiho, his son. He is in charge of the island chain. Nobody lands without his permission, and nobody stays without his permission. So he gives them a one-year lease, and he pretty much says where they will be. And they're allowed to be in the courts. They're not wandering the neighborhood. They're in the different courts. They're at Kailua Kona. They're in Lahaina. They're in Honolulu. They're placed where they are asked to be. Like I said, they just got rid of a religion. You know, they just gave up on that. They weren't looking for a new one. And there's not a dive into Christianity. Keopuolani recognizes right away the value of writing and the value of sewing. And those are really probably what the missionaries were most appreciated for. The other thing is the value of pono. And I teach the graduate level Hawaiian language classes. And when they're reading the old Hawaiian texts, whether it's Kamakau or I'i or anybody, I have to make them pay attention that every time it's mentioned about the pono, that does not equal Christianity. Ka'ahumanu embraced the pono. This new team that was on board, these missionaries, had a set of ethics that they had not run into in the 40 years of interaction. They come from, it's the second great awakening on the in America, and they come from a very intentionally non, what do you call, they're not invested in themselves. They are expected to do good without expecting anything in return. And so they just do good. Well, Ka'ahu Manu and everybody, she's had people coming ashore since she was 10 years old. Liholiho has had visitors from outside since he was born. Mostly they all either want food, water, your daughter, or your land. I mean, somebody, you know, or a prophet at least. They're, you know, most folks who land are after something, and these guys aren't. Ka'ahu Manu picks up on it right away. She pushes the pono, and there's much discussion about the pono for 5 years before she finally converts to Christianity. Those are two different things. The set of ethics, which are based in a Christian ethic, but the notion of Christianity is a whole different package. So it's something to watch for. But what she immediately grasped was the value of literacy. She wanted it. So this is a picture, and it says at the bottom, and you'll see, it's with the Hawaiians. The missionaries come here, they don't speak Hawaiian. And so they have to work with the Hawaiian chiefs to learn Hawaiian and learn a system. They're immediately put to work teaching all the high chiefs, Ka'ahu Manu, Kawikeoli. They're all in class learning to read and write English. That's the only thing the missionaries could teach until they learned Hawaiian. So they work together. This says that she is promoting Christianity. I don't think so, actually. If this is early, look what they've all got books in their hands. She's promoting reading and writing right away. She doesn't promote Christianity heavily until 1825. They're on the ground for 5 years before she, you know, she was the conqueror's wife, favorite wife. When he passed away, she's busy. She's running a kingdom and she has a new husband. You know, she immediately married Kaumualii and then married his son. She's busy. She didn't need a new religion right away. They worked together to create, and the missionaries that came were actually a very skilled bunch. They're very well schooled. They're linguists. They're able to put things in place. And the people they're working with are the highest level of chiefs and knowledgeable folks. So they put a system. The pi'apa, if you all know it, means you put a p with a a, you get pa. They made the writing system so close to the spoken system that it said that a fluent 18-year-old could learn to read and write in 18 hours. All you had to do was listen to what you're saying, and it matches up with what you're writing. This is, and actually I want to dive forward, this is a letter. This is the timing on this. They arrive in 1820, the missionaries do. They set to work, they're teaching English. At the end of 1821, they have actually gotten the pi'apa is together. They've finally set up a system for writing. So Elizabeth Ka'ahu Manu is already fluent, are able to read and write in English, some. But then the Hawaiian format comes out and she jumps on it. This is written 5 months after the system was created. Look at, that's her handwriting, and I'll show you a little closer piece of it. She has beautiful handwriting, but she's very fluent in this. And the reason I highlight the letter, this is the first letter we have from her. And at the bottom of her letter, mostly she's writing to Kamehamalu. Now that's Liholiho's queen who goes with him to England and dies. This is before that fatal journey. And she's writing to say, I want to introduce your new uncle, my new husband. And says, you know, we send our aloha and whatnot. We got your letter, but we only got one letter. There's three or four of us here. She says, I want 800 letters. She says, you're there with the long necks. That's what they call the missionary wives. You're there with the long necks. Get them to help you. I want plenty of letters. This line on the bottom of the first page, we want literacy. It'll make us wise. And to me, a really interesting piece, and it's still, I'm still gelling on it. If you can see, she's added in the word a'o. She originally wrote, make make nui mako ika palapala. We want the reading and writing. Ke a'o palapala means the teaching of it. We want the education to happen. And what's in that same letter, the signature, this to me, I'd already finished this letter. We gave it to the mission houses. By the way, these are all available through Mission Houses Museum website. I'd already handed it in before I realized what had happened here. Because we're real accustomed to scratch outs. They're writing with a quill pen, right? So, and paper is really sort of a luxury, so you don't waste it. But this is signed by Kaumuali'i and Ka'ahumanu. That's their signatures. But it says, me, your auntie, Ka'ahumanu. And then it's signed Kaumuali'i. It's not scratched out because there's not room. What he's doing there is this is the way it's always been written. That's how he'd seen it from scratch. Tamori'i. And that's how you've seen it. Because that's how all the early journeyers, you know, they Tamori'i. He wrote it as he'd received it. And then he applied the system. No, it's Ta-u-mu-a-ri-i, and he rewrote it. The wonder of this stuff is it not only, we're not talking about the Ali'i, we're actually almost on the desk with them. Many of these are such a personal window into the past. It's wonderful. Okay. But I digress. Oh, and that's what I do, by the way. I digress for the most part. Because there's too much. So we'll get as much in as we can, and then we'll be done. Kawi Keoli learns English with that first year of training and then moves right into it. He's one of the earliest students. When Liholiho dies and he's gone off to London, and they don't actually put Kawi Keoli on the throne until the bodies are brought back, until they officially know that Liholiho is dead. And then he steps to the throne, and he's 12 years old. And in his opening speech, he says, mine will be a nation of literacy. We have to credit Liholiho with making literacy happen. He helped foster and made time for all of the missionaries and the chiefs who helped them make sense out of it. But then Liholiho, as a 12-year-old, steps up, and he not only says, I want my nation to be literate. I mean, that's kind of an easy thing to say. He builds a system immediately that says, have a school in every district. You're the konohiki, you must provide land, you must provide the building, you must provide the food. If you don't, you're not the konohiki anymore. That's how serious this got. Starts with the schools and the royal courts. They all send them out to the districts. As soon as people are fluent enough to teach, they're sent out to teach in the rural districts. Korohiki would lose their lands if they did not support the schools, and they set up a teacher's college so that all of those little schools will end up having good regional teachers. So universal literacy of the nation, and universal 95 to 100% in 30 years. That was higher literacy than America or England at the time. It's higher than we are today. Lahaina School, Luna School, set up in 1831, and all of the high chiefs were allowed to send their best, and that's who the first students were. Most of the students were in their 30s and 40s. Now it's a high school, of course. It was at the school that they set up the newspapers. And, you know, newspapers are no longer news, and that's why, you know, we gave this a subtitle. But maybe it is to some, is that the newspapers were meant to be a teaching tool. Really, that's all it was. But immediately, everyone wanted it. So it's being published at Lahaina Luna and circulated among the students. They have to print enough to fill everyone's desire. So it goes to Kauai and it goes to Kau. It's everywhere. And another side note is that Hawaiians were so hungry. Now you've got the chiefs leaning on them to learn to read and write. In Kawi Keoli's speech, he actually says, the man who reads and writes is my man. If you don't do that, you're not my man. So there's a lot of pressure to do this. Hawaiians were equally adept at reading right side up, upside down, and sideways. And that's because the presses couldn't keep up with the demand. So if you owned the book, you read right side up. And the other four people around you read at an angle. And now, as a kid, I used to be able to read upside down because I was nosy, and my sister always had a book. So when I read that note, and Laura Fish Judd is who described that. And she was real impressed. I thought, well, it can be done. But so this first newspaper kicked off a piece, and it's, you know, done by the teachers at Lahaina Luna and the students. So these students are pretty knowledgeable people. You've got David Marlowe, you've got Kamakau is up there. They are able to put some remarkable stuff. The first newspapers are sometimes dismissed as a missionary product, as though that wouldn't have value. But the very first one has a kanikau for the aikane of Kahikili. So there's some good, meaty Hawaiian matter in these. But the newspapers become a new passion. And for 25 years, they're mostly smaller. And in 1861, now I'm going to ask you to kind of follow me in dates. So newspapers started 34, okay? So within about 25 years, an independent press. This is no longer done by the school. It's no longer done. A bunch of the newspapers were provided by the government. And the last government paper, the Kahai Hawaii, the goal of the paper was to make Hawaiians be passionate about newspapers. Well, the product was they went independent. They became commercial. So you have Kahoku Okapaki Pika. But look at this. It's the size of the Wall Street Journal. There are no margins because paper is expensive, so it's just totally jammed together. And I don't know if you read the Honolulu Star Advertiser. It has about 3.5 typescripted pages of text on each page of newspaper. This is a little bit bigger, not much, and it has 12 to 14 pages. If we type this out, this makes a stack of paper. So that comes into play. This is the last newspaper. That one, the other one was the first big newspaper, the first independent press. This is the last one. They ran until 1948. Now, that surprises some folks who you might have heard Hawaiian was banned or Hawaiian. Well, Hawaiian was never banned. Hawaiian was turned, English was made the language of instruction in 1896. And it's an important distinction that it wasn't banned. There was still a people that spoke and read and people that only spoke Hawaiian. There was still a large population that only spoke Hawaiian. They'd not learned English yet. And so the newspapers were viable until 1948. In the course of that run, there's 100 different newspapers come out, each one with a different angle. There's 125,000 pages of newspapers. Now, we've only gotten together about 75 or 80,000 of that 125, but that's huge. And it was, I ended up getting a PhD on this, so I can really get boring. But what we did, and I want to walk you through, we didn't map any of this. I've been a Hawaiian language teacher for almost 35 years. We used the newspapers, but it was such a random, you dive in, you don't even know what's around, and you find a treasure, and then you walk away. And you might be able to find that treasure again or not, you know, hard to say. But I was trying to find a comparison. It would be like, and I was going to say, taking a pen light to go through a darkened library. But no, because there's a system, a logic that you know that operates there. Think more like trying to investigate a patchwork quilt with a pen light, only the patchwork quilt is the size of the Kona district. Okay, so the pieces that you find, might you don't even know what's around it. Okay, so that's where it was running. It wasn't until we started to look at what is here, the 125,000 pages, once we got the number of newspapers, the number of pages, and then we looked around at the Pacific. Well, Maoris had newspapers, Samoans had newspapers, Tahitians had newspapers, and we found out the Maoris had about 30,000 pages of newspapers. So they OCR, the optical character recognition, you know, technology, all of their newspapers. It took them about a year. We thought, okay, multiply by four, we got it. Okay, that's where the differences started to appear, is Hawaii was a nation. Every newspaper was running from Kauai to Kau. Most of the Maori newspapers were regional. All the Maori newspapers stayed this size. So 30,000 pages of newspaper made 30,000 typescript pages. This 125,000, which has very different content because it's national. Because the Maoris, when they were doing theirs, and I don't mean to offend a Maori, this is not a complaint, it's a report, is they were outnumbered by outsiders at the time they're trying to do this. So every time they do a newspaper, they pretty much have to go, is this all right? Is this all right? Anybody annoyed? Hawaii never had to do that. So the content is incredibly different. But also just the numbers. We type out the 125,000, it's 1.5 million pages of text. And that's just newspapers. It's larger than all the Maoris, all the Tahitian, all the Samoan, all the Tongan, Fijian together. It's larger than the printed material of the rest of the Polynesian, the rest of the Pacific. It's actually larger, just this part of the when I talk about the legacy of literacy, just this block of it is larger than the repository of American, Native American published works. This little island chain. How did that happen? It's the marriage of independence that launched all this, and they could do it their way, and that the newspapers became a focus. I'm probably getting ahead of myself. Oh, well, I want to talk about the content in it, okay? Is from the beginning, Hawaiians took newspapers really seriously, more seriously than books. Really, there's only about a dozen secular books done in Hawaiian. There's a bunch of hymnals, and there's a Bible, of course. There's, you know, a lot of printed material, but most of it is either educational or it's governmental. There's very few secular books that were done. And it's partly the marriage of an oral society to the modern technology of writing. Is if it's wrong in a book, it's still on the shelf next year. And there's no opportunity for change. The newspapers have a flexibility. If you're writing a genealogy and you miss a generation, I can write in and say, you missed that. There's an interactive part of the newspapers that was really resonant with Hawaiian society. And it's something that you really have to watch for, too. As we research back into this, I find the article this is the magic answer. This is the bullet I was looking for. It's everything. It's wonderful. You can't stop there. You have to look around for a month or two to see if anyone wrote in to add to it, take away from it, correct it, replace it. You know, so that flexibility is actually a research problem. But this is early on. This is still in Kalama, Hawaii. And I think it was Matayo Ke Kono'a who said, the chiefs, you must embrace it. We'll lose our traditional knowledge if we don't put it into print. This is a safe place for it. To avoid that, let it be printed. And show the people the chiefs care. This is a little bit later. Samuel Kamakau, who becomes a great historian. Not that he's always perfectly accurate. Bobby, we know. But he says we really try to get the best because this is for future. Now, all this is going on, by the way. Here's another one. And this one, I found this in 1990. And when I read this guy saying, those of you who are knowledgeable, put it in the newspaper because those in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, and 130 years will need to know. Because all of this was happening at the same time that the population was crashing. By the time that independent press came out, the population had diminished 50% between the arrival of the missionaries, just that 40-year span. So at the time, a knowledgeable person dying was like a library burning down. And, you know, that was lamented oftentimes. The very first great telling of the Hi'iaka, the story, Hi'iaka I Kapoliopele. Oh, yeah, you guys know that. She's right up there. Kapihe Nui wrote it, or put it in the paper. And then there was a great lament when his mother passed away because she was the holder of the story. And they said, those like her who are these calabashes of knowledge, we've got to get it in the paper. And that's what this was about. And that encouragement made a watershed. The things started to pour into the paper that you wouldn't have expected. It was embraced as a national repository. This is a safe place forever. this is a chant written by Kamehameha the First, or so it's credited in the paper. The one on the left, or the other one, is written by Moihonua. But this is supposedly by Kamehameha the First. Now, what strikes me there, this would be 1860s. Kamehameha, of course, didn't write down his chants. And I don't know if you know how that system, children or young people who were good at memorizing were established as memorizers. That was, you know, a skill set. You could be a carpenter, you could be a canoe carver, you could be a memorizer. Kekau Luohi was a memorizer. That was her early youth. She was given genealogies and legends and histories, and that was, she was expected to know those things. Somebody was assigned when he composed this at the birth of his second son, or his third son. No, second son, sorry, it's Kamehameha the third. Somebody was assigned to memorize it. But they couldn't have been the person to put it in the paper, so they had to hand that in the family. This was a family treasure. And they decided it was okay to put it in the newspapers. That's huge. And it really was a watershed. But this span of newspapers, 1834 to 1948, it covers directly the absolute monarchy, the constitutional monarchy, the overthrow period, the alleged annexation of the territory, and because the specialists who were trying to share knowledge from before, it covers all almost from early settlement. Well, it covers from Genesis, basically. I mean, it's there that we get part of the origin chants. So the material that's in there is the window on Hawaii from the inside. And I often think, you know, the history that we all learned from, and I don't care where you learned it, Kamehameha schools, you know, Punahou, books you picked up in the library, none of them contained this material. That's important. It's a unique legacy. This is handed down, and it was intentionally handed down. That's exactly how I see it. I focus on newspapers, but the newspapers make sense out of the archives of manuscript material. I've been in the archives for 35, 40 years. I have more dust in my nostrils than most living humans. And it's random. It's unintelligible. It's different collections, and oftentimes they're not connected up. The newspapers give us an insider chronology that makes all of this make sense. It makes a lot of it make sense. Some of it is still pretty obscure. But it also makes great sense out of the government documents. So when you find different government pieces, there's often parallel newspaper accounts that cover why that was happening, why this new kind of law or document was in place. So we've got this huge body, one of the largest on the planet of indigenous language, right? 100 different newspapers, 125,000 pages of material equal to a million and a half pages worth of stuff. And it fades into obscurity. In the last century, only 2 to 3% of it has ever been included in any history book you ever used. 97% of it sits there untouched. How did that fade out of view, right? How did this become so invisible? And there's really only one answer, is that society moved to English. There was such a drive to learn English. So even though now, 1896, they stopped teaching Hawaiian in any schools, but already there were very few Hawaiian language schools. A lot of Hawaiian families had lobbied to have their kids learn in English, because that was the new language of commerce, business, government. You know, they want their kids to excel. So English was just a growing force. But now you have young people aren't educated in Hawaiian. They can't read it and write it. The whole territory period is filled with newspaper articles bitching about the kids, that they can't speak Hawaiian for beans, that their English is terrible. They're just going to be nothing, you know, if they don't clean up and go one way or the other. So there's a lot of pressure to excel, and English was what to excel in. So these kids from the turn of the century never read a newspaper. They didn't remember. They didn't even remember they were there, you know, for the most part. The few native speaker communities like Niihau, some of the Kona districts, some in Kau, where they were still getting the newspaper up till 1948. A lot of the native speakers that ended up living into the modern age were because they were forced to read to their grandparents when the newspaper came, or they read to their grandparents from the Bible. And those two things, because then, you know, grandma or grandpa would say, "Not, it's not pa'u, it's pa'u, wapulu, wapa'u." And they'd correct, you know, the pronunciation that they were getting, and they ended up as native speakers. That counteracted this a little bit. But for the whole of the 20th century, these were pretty much in a little pocket. So who had access to them? I had access, because I was a treasure hunter. I was a language teacher like you, and we went to look. But we didn't even know what we were looking at. Really, it's like investigating, you know, the Carlsbad Caverns with a pen light. You know, you're not going to. So, and Auntie Edith McKenzie, I don't know if anybody would know Auntie Edith. She was a real character in my life, and she, every time that I saw her, because she was in the newspapers all the time, and she'd go, "Oh, look at this, look at this." She'd find treasures, she'd find diamonds, and it'd be a wonderful thing. But she never knew what the whole picture looked like. And when we unfolded this, which was not too long before she passed away, she was so excited to go, "Oh, that's how that all connects up." You know, it's that because these diamonds pieces were just, you know, they were a find. They weren't part of a bigger fabric. And there was a fabric and intent. So the treasure hunters and language teachers became part of the treasure hunters. But once we found a good article, we'd use it for 10 years. It's not like we were doing heady research. 2000, we start this geography. We're mapping out what is there. How many are there? I mean, there were union lists. Esther Mulkini had done a union list. Helen Chapin listed newspapers. But they'd never really tallied. Well, how big are those newspapers? When you say Kuokoa ran for 70 years, well, what does that look like? So we put it all together, and that's where we got the numbers, the 100 newspapers, the 125,000 pages. So we started to map that out. And then the archaeologists, about 2003, we actually got enough of it OCR'd. We started to do manually guided OCR. Does everybody know what OCR is? Optical character recognition. If you scan something through your scanner, it'll actually pop it up as a Microsoft Word document or something. It'll read all the words. It works perfectly on anything that was typed in the last 30 years. Now, Hawaiian language teachers were right on the cutting edge. When OCR came out, we jumped on it like nothing. It was such chaos, it was worthless, because the error rate was like 85%. It's easier just to type it. You don't get over it. It was so bad. And the link that we had with the Maori newspapers was we had learned they had found an OCR program that with human management, you could actually get it down to about a 20% error rate. Now, that was on their small papers. And we were just in the process. We'd given up, as it was chaos, and it was not a technology that was ever going to apply. Hawaiian language papers were 150 years old, and they were badly printed when they were new. And now they're old and dusty and broken, and, you know. So Dwayne Steele, who some of you might know Dwayne Steele, he decided, well, let's employ the Ni'ihau community to manually type the newspapers back into searchable text. They've got the language skill. Let's make use of that. Nobody's making use of that wonderful skill. We can create a whole new industry. I was sent to Kauai with a microfilm reader and a Macintosh to do typing tests on Ni'ihauans. How's that for a career success? Almost across the board, they were atrocious at typing. And it was averaging like 15 words a minute. And they were easily sidetracked because they're reading these articles, and so it's not. So there were a lot of problems, and when we did the numbers on this, it was going to take us 150 years to type in what had only taken 100 years to actually do originally. So, but as we came back with those numbers and were a little on the edge of defeat, this Maori program came up, and so we were able to use, and it's called Abbey Fine Reader. And with some help from a, now it's more widespread and whatnot, but with help from a manual operator, but you have to be fluent in Hawaiian to track it, you could actually, you saw the margins don't exist. Well, any good OCR program reads right across the page, which, yeah, just turned everything into chaos. So they could lay out the margins and they could correct it as it came out. So we actually got some really good quality, searchable text just from the first, like, 1,000 pages. In 2003, we started to find being able to search those newspapers was invaluable. You ask me, you know, well, what was the background on Hualalai? Well, I can hit, today we have 75,000 pages up, all searchable. Ask me about Hualalai, word search, 4,000 hits, perhaps. Not everyone will be a great article, but it's there, and we can find it. Anyway, okay, so today, that's where we are today. Today, it's accessible to everybody. You can all go home and play on the Hawaiian language newspapers tonight. If you don't have to speak Hawaiian to be able to know, is that a recipe, an editorial, or an ad? I mean, you know, you could do at least that much. But it's really, and a lot of the material has been translated now. I say a lot, you'll think it's a little bit compared to 1.5 million pages. We probably have a couple of thousand pages translated. It takes time. That's part of the reason for my talk. By the way, how am I on time? 15 minutes to the hour. Oh my. Well, there's that. Okay. Because I do want to leave time to talk because there's things that I won't be able to get to. This actually became possible because in 1970, they predicted Hawaiian would be a dead language in 10 years. The median age of speakers was about 80 years old. There were very few children that spoke the language. It would be considered a dead language. The revitalization movement started in the 70s, and unlike most of the rest of the world, it succeeded. Hawaii is now a model for the whole world on pulling a language from the brink of language death to pretty vibrant. 25,000 speakers is a rough estimate. And that's not a big number. There's 1 million of us on the island chain, and 25,000 of us are pretty gabby in Hawaiian. It's not enough. But it's more than, you know, come on, there's a lot of languages that simply disappeared. And it grew all the way along. So 1980s, they kicked off immersion schools. 1990s, they're already doing graduate education in the language. Now you can go from birth, literally. I mean, they have hi'ipepe, you know, the little baby, all the way up to PhD in Hawaiian language, where the language of instruction is Hawaiian. That's a huge success. It's sort of a little teeny pocket of us. I just scolded my class. I teach graduate classes. I teach a writing class. And about halfway through the semester, I said, there are less than 100 of you on the planet that have been educated to this level. And if I'm correcting your spelling, if I'm horrified at your grammar, what do you think that does to my hopes for the future of this language? And so if you don't get an A, don't be terribly surprised, because every word that I correct, that grade goes to me, not to you. So there were a lot of B's and C's. But it turned around. That lecture is a really good lecture to give, because nobody's doing this because they're going to get rich, I promise. They're doing it because they have a personal investment. And that just kind of called them all to the fore. And I got a lot better papers for the last half of the semester. Anyway, so now we're doing graduate classes, and it is a global success. It's something to take great pride in. And the folks who are doing that on the inside are to be congratulated. But it's really all of Hawaii has helped make that happen. Well, except for the government. But, yeah, I mean, because in many ways it's been a grassroots, and the families that put their kids in got support from their friends and their families. This could never have been possible if it hadn't been embraced as something worthwhile. So congratulate yourselves. But there is a crisis about that, is that while the revitalization dropped people like me into archives with a new eye and a new ability, There's actually been very little, this opening of the resources, and this is the second half of my story, which I'll do quite quickly. It's just something that I'm concerned about, and I think it's very important that we get a clear vision of what is up, is that very little of this opening of resources has been connected into the revitalization movement, whether it's at the immersion schools or whether it's at our own universities. Little of this is piecemeal coming in, and I want to kind of highlight that. Most of the projects that are being the most productive are at the margins of the language movement. And that's these are some of them. Ho'olaupai'i did the newspapers. Awaiolu, I train translators. Hawaii Sea Grant has invested a lot into translating marine science kinds of things. That they came to us and said, come on, Hawaiians had to write about fishing, right? Mercy, is that a rich field. Jaimar does weather. And they ask us to look into weather material. I'll show you some of that. NOAA has pulled on us. The College of Education is putting it into curriculum. And the last is we set up an Institute of Hawaiian Language Research and Translation. Because I was leaving the university to take on Awaiolu full-time. And I went to the president and said, I'm not asking, but I'm offering. I would stay and set this up, and we'll train more grad students to do what we're doing. Because it's not happening in the classrooms. Because while revitalization is succeeding over here, most of the projects that are developing both translators and translator material are happening outside of that. It's been a bit of a historical disconnect. But there is, I mean, it's filtering in. The immersion folks look for their own stuff, or we look for our own stuff. And some of this project stuff wanders over there, but it's not well connected up. We have drawn materials for the immersion schools from the newspapers, and that's been about the block of it. Big blocks of Hawaiian language. If you don't know all these books, they're all available because we made every effort to make it available to everyone, but they're all in Hawaiian. So this is the whole of the Kamakau story, the first two volumes here. We did reprints, we did pull it out of the newspaper. There were some really dynamic efforts in the mostly the 1990s. But we're building all this stuff. Duane Steele was a force for me. He was my student, and then he became my sort of fellow revolutionary. And we decided that every Hawaiian language student should have a shelf of Hawaiian language books that they could choose from. And so we just started everywhere we could. We pulled Kamakau from the newspapers, published it. He paid for that. For the most part, he paid for me to, because nobody had ever been trained as an editor or a type. What is that called when you check, not the typesetter, but the checker, proofreaders, and you know all of the the pieces that go into making these things of any quality, and this one with Kamehameha on the cover was the first book of its kind in a century, published in Hawaiian, published beautifully. With real care, and cost him like $70,000, but he wanted to make a mark to say the language of power and the power of language. He had come to me to say, grown-ups have never seen a real book in Hawaiian. You can get a degree at this university and never see a real book. It's all computer printouts or newspaper copies, and it's important that they see it be real. So we invested in that, and it cost a fortune, and it changed the way Hawaiian books are published today. But so he came to me. I did this dissertation, and we ended up publishing it afterwards because I gave him my dissertation, and he read it in a night. And basically, my dissertation said, there's this much stuff. We use about this much. Oh, my. So he shows up at my house at 8 in the morning and says, well, what are you doing about it? He and I are like the two most over-caffeinated, wildly enthused characters that I know. And we, just the pair of us with our little teams that we assemble, had made like 18 books already, completely outside of the system. And I said, and he said, it's not about knowledge. It's not about language, it's about knowledge. We've got to keep doing everything we do. Everything that gets done for Hawaiian language has to keep going. But it also, he said, 95% of Hawaiians can't read the books we make. 99% of the general population can't. We've got to make that knowledge available to all of them. The world needs this knowledge. So he says, so we have to keep doing everything we do, but we have to do it bilingually. I said, there are no translators. There had been no translation for 50 years. Basically, 50 years, no translation. And this was, there was an antagonism. Translation was the enemy of revitalization. And each of these is a story, and I don't know if I have time. These are the pearls. When I was in Larry Kimura's 402, I came into it not up through the ranks. I came into it from the side. I knew Hawaiian when I got to the university. I just knew Hawaiian badly. And so the university buffed that into shape. But so I got asked to translate the biography of Joseph Nawahi. And you probably know who Joseph Nawahi was. He's a huge political force. He was an advisor to Liliuokalani. He's the name of the school over in Keaʻau, I guess. And Larry said, please don't translate that. He said, these are the pearls. And people have to learn Hawaiian if they're going to get at them. And I get it. Because at the time, he only knew of six or seven like that. And they were treasures. I convinced him because I said, I read this and nobody knows who this man is. And he's incredible. He's a self-taught lawyer. He's a surveyor. He's a political master. He was a nationalist. He's a hero. And he died in the process. So, I mean, this is, everybody needs to know about this man. Not just Hawaiian kids, but everybody needs to know. And he agreed. So he wouldn't help me translate it, but he'd help me understand it. But now fast forward, and those pearls that he was holding, you know, he said, these are the pearls. He only knew of six or seven. Now we have 700. They weren't never meant to be pearls. They were meant to be building blocks. They were meant to be paving stones. They were meant to be publicly embraced. So, you know, I disagree with that one. I disapprove. So I have a PhD candidate coming out of the college in Hilo, who you all know and probably love. And he comes to Honolulu to sit on my steps and wait for me to come home. And I didn't come home. So I had to go back to Hilo. And then he came again and sat on my steps and waited for me to come home. So he could tell me, I disapprove of what you do, of you translating. I think that it's counterproductive to the immersion movement. And I would like you to be on my PhD committee. So we had a really very good talk about many of the qualities that I have, many of the kind of knowledge that I have that he's seeking for his committee is because I do translation. And so, you know, okay, now he's kind of changed his mind and he's a cheerleader now, but that's 5-8 years, okay? And so the few who can do translation, and it's hard to do translation well. I mean, I do it because I worked with old folks who could explain. So the few who did have that resource don't do it. They're busy. It's not because they're, you know, they resent it. They're busy. They're running schools. They're running programs. You know, they're running family, but they're not doing translation. So it's not mostly happening. So what the process is shaped by history, the stuff that's in this old material, it's hard stuff. It is hard stuff. It's dense. And the fact that modern history shapes it, the fact that it has not been articulated into the immersion, revitalization, Hawaiian language movement, means that the kids who are very fluent today, when they look at the old material, they're in deep water, they're lost. So what do we do there? I describe it as we train a generation in four colors and then we ask them to describe rainbows. They get lost. So what, and this just kind of, you know, it's the same kind of thing. We're building new access, but we need to connect that up with the language revitalization. Because the more of the fluent kids that have easy, that are comfortable in that zone, the more that can pour back out. And all of this stuff that laid dormant for 100 years needs to be rearticulated. There's some wonderful stuff. I set up, when Duane Steele came to me and said, we have to translate, I said, there are no translators. He was a business wizard. That's what his thing was. So he just went, click, you can make translators. let's make translators. You know, that was his skill. So he set up what was called Awayaulu and gave me a year off of school and two interns. He paid for both of those. And they sat at my side and we translated Hi'iaka Ika Poli Opele, which was a 500-page, if you don't have it, it's on Amazon or it's on our website, come buy it. It's a rocking story. It was published 12 times in the Hawaiian newspapers, different versions. We picked the biggest one. It's almost 500 pages long. It had never been translated. No version had ever been translated. The one published version is by Emerson, and it's not a translation. It's a retelling. So 12 of these lay in the dust. We pull one out, and the American Folklore Society, the year that it came out, said, this is world literature. Where has it been? Well, there it was. It was hanging out in the newspapers. But the process of doing that, it took almost 2 years, and it gave them great skill. Now they go on, and that's what we do, is I take the two, then they take on mentors, or they mentor two others, and I keep getting pushed higher in the pyramid until finally I'm like the old guy on the top of the mountain. But right now we have six in one pyramid. We're working on the second volume of the Kamakau material. We have four in another pyramid. We're working on historical letters. Never a dull moment. But that's what I've been doing for 12, 13 years. That's what I took to David Lasner and said, I'm not asking, I'm offering. And he said, let's give it a try. So the university, I have to say, it's a little bit Awayaulu light, because they're not my mentees, they're grad students. But they're on task, it's more product oriented and they don't get as much training. But at least they're getting experience in the actual, get your hands in there, get it out, make it make sense. You know, because they can translate it beautifully about like Google does. I mean, they'll get all the words and then I go, well, what does that mean? Go, I don't know. It's all in English, but I don't know. Yeah. So getting them to know is the biggest piece. So we can at least, we've got six GRAs on task right now and they're all getting experience in the field. So it's in motion. I know this must seem like such a little thing. If this was a business, we'd be bankrupt already. But, you know, it's just every movement starts. Oh, we're almost there. Okay, we're almost there, promise. This is the product. I was proud to put the beautiful version of this in 200 libraries around the world as a symbol of the opening up of Hawaiian knowledge. There's a lot of product. That's one of the products we pulled out. This is part of what Sea Grant has been doing, both publications and websites. Jaimar, we pulled 4,000 articles on weather, historical weather. And one of the pieces of that, we were able, now I don't know if you'll like this, there was legislation to drop the hurricane insurance for Hawaii Island, because once upon a time, everybody thought Hawaii Island was immune to hurricanes. This is pre-Isel. So pre-Isel, I handed in that 4,000 historical articles on weather, and the guy on top of it said, you know, I'm really only interested in hurricanes, and I have a mention from Kohala Seminary about a terrible storm in 1871. Would there be anything? We had 16 articles on that one storm in Hawaii. And they were able to take our translations and extrapolate the data to show it was a level 3 hurricane, track the full trajectory and the impact rates. It came up through Waipio, smacked Hamakua and Kohala, went across to Maui, over Molokai and out to sea. The legislation died. You're all still paying insurance. I'm not sorry. Because when Isel hit, that was $20 million in damage, and it was all insured. So it didn't go to you guys directly. Okay. College of Ed is building this into their curriculum. They're picking from other stuff. There's websites that are putting up English and Hawaiian so that you can have both. It's important to have both. This is our institute website is hosted by Sea Grant. There's 400 or 500 articles there in different topics that you can dig through. We're just moving to reconnect it. By reconnecting it, we're going to make modern proficiency, modern fluency in Hawaiian broader. There's so many words, there's grammar, there's all kinds of stuff that isn't being taught yet. Touch them, and it'll be absorbed. But there's also all the historical data that's so important to understand. So we're going to link it up. These are some of the online resources. We can make this available through any place, really. Newspaper.org has all of the images of the newspaper and most of the searchable stuff. OHA's Papakilo database has 75,000 pages of newspaper, and it's all searchable. It's kind of rudimentary, you know, it's a little iffy, but Awaiaulu is our website, and it has what it has. Nupepa Hawaii is the one that I just showed you. He's one of our Awaiaulu people, and he just does whatever interests him. Today, he's done an article on Liliuokalani. Tomorrow, he's doing roses in Waimea. You know, it can be really, it's totally random. And our new site under Sea Grant is a big piece. Outside of the newspapers, the Mission Houses has really made a dedicated effort to make their materials, and they have some very rich historical materials, make them available on digital on the websites. So do check those out. I often compare, you know, I mean, oftentimes you know there's an historical site out there and it's just a lump of rock and whatnot. You don't know if it was a trash heap or a ceremonial temple, right? That's Pukohola. Well, we found our, I mean, we knew it was there. We always knew it was there. But when we excavated it, it was a five-story library. That's what we feel like. And we've got the lights on three of the floors. That's about where we are. So, and it's there. Now, how do we get to it? The library awaits. How much effort do we put into reconnecting it up? And that's, I think, the end of my talk. Okay.